my name's Mark Renz, and I'm going to talk to you today about how to identify Japanese barberry, which is a relatively new invasive shrub that's invading Wisconsin and nearby states. Many of you are probably familiar with Japanese barberry is because it's a really common urban shrub that's found in many individuals' front yards, and actually is a really an excellent shrub for this, because it is a low-maintenance shrub that can tolerate all of the harsh conditions that an urban environment has, such as lack of taking care of it, watering it, challenging soils, and even wildlife herbivory such as deer as well as rabbits. It also can really tolerate a wide range of environmental conditions, from full sun to shade, and so that's another reason why it's such a great urban shrub. And also it has some really good traits that really make it very attractive, such as changing fall color and a range of colors of foliage and these very beautiful persistent red fruits that persist throughout the winter. But this species has a bad side too. It is highly invasive in our forests in the understory. And when established, it can dominate these forest understories. What are some of the impacts the species has? It clearly will displace native plants and animals. It makes it very difficult to recreate in those areas because of the spiny nature of the plant, as you'll see, and the denseness with the infestations established. And probably worst of all, it supports ticks that can have Lyme disease, and so therefore is a potential increase in a threat to human health by having this plant species develop in our forested systems. So how do we identify Japanese barberry? I'm going to go through a series of characteristics to help you aid in identification. First, I'm going to talk about the overall stem characteristics of this species. As I mentioned before, it's a compact shrub, which can be anywhere from 1 to several feet in height, which tends to generally, in horticultural situations, have round shrub with many dense, spiny stems. As you can see, it'll look a little bit different in the wild. And these stems tend to grow from node to node in more or less of a zigzag type of form in many cases. And these stems are very, very characteristic, with deeply grooved stems that are reddish to brownish to even grayish color. And one of the real unique things is they have this very distinct spine that is sharp and protrudes at each node, and it's just one individual spine. The leaves are also quite unique. They're rather small and spatula shaped, as you can see here, which have a very narrow petiole-like appendage that broadens out into a flat-like leaf. They're fairly small, a half inch, but they can get quite large, up to 1.5 inches long, and they tend to alternate along the stem, although we tend to see them born in clusters, as you can see here along the stem at that node where there's a spine attached. I think what makes this plant challenging to identify is the leaf color can vary quite dramatically depending on the environment and some of the genetics of this species too. So that can be a challenge in identification of this species. The flowers and fruit are also quite unique and easy and can assist in identification. They have these yellow umbrella-shaped flowers that are actually quite small, only 1/4 inch wide. They do have 6 petals, and they tend to be tough to identify unless you see those at the right stage of development. And they're also found along these stems individually or in clusters. And as those flowers mature later on in the summer through the winter, we get these beautiful red fruit that develop. They're oblong, they're a little over 1/4 inch long, 0.3 inches long. And as I mentioned before, they can mature through winter and are the major source of dispersal of this species. Well, realize, although we've been talking about these identifying characteristics, the form of Japanese barberry can look quite a bit different in natural areas. Here's 2 pictures of establishing smaller populations. They're quite small, not as compact, much more leggy in their development. But as populations get more dense, we can get these very dense thickets. Many people likely confuse these with general brambles or plants in the rubus family without looking in detail at the identifying characteristics of the stem, the leaves, the flowers, and the fruit that we've just discussed. So how widespread is it in Wisconsin? We actually have it present in many of our counties, not all of our counties in Wisconsin. And as you can see to the right here, these are the known georeference locations that we have spotted and have collected. If you know of a population that's naturalized in a forest that's not depicted on this map, we highly recommend that you report this through local channels, which we'll highlight at the end of this recording. Really, there's one species that you're likely to get confused and misidentify Japanese barberry with, and it's another introduced barberry, European or common barberry, Berberis vulgaris. The three main ways to differentiate this plant from Japanese barberry is that the margins of the leaf often have these very sharp teething on it that Japanese barberry does not have. The second characteristic that's really good is that we often see three distinct spines at a node lining the branches, whereas Japanese barberry, as we you recall, only has one. And finally, we tend to get European barberry tends to be a little bit taller than Japanese barberry and more loosely arranged. Although I don't think this is that great of a characteristic because often Japanese barberry has that similar appearance in many of our forest systems where it's escaping and is naturalized. So the big question that a lot of people have is, so we have a lot of Japanese barberry on the landscape, it's in a lot of ornamental areas. Should we be concerned about it continuing to spread throughout the state of Wisconsin? And the short answer is yes. This is some research that we've done that highlights the suitable environment for Japanese barberry. And as you can see, we have a lot of suitable area that Japanese barberry has not yet invaded, indicated by the red and orange colors in the map. If we look at the different types of habitats, we find that the most suitable habitats for invasion in the state are forested areas, followed by urban areas, and then getting into some lower frequency in wetlands, barrens, and other areas. And what you can see is what a clear driver in suitable habitat is shading or canopy. The more shading that is present, the more likely that this species is to invade, although there's a series of climatic variables as well as canopy cover that's related to suitable habitat for Japanese barberry. So to summarize, Japanese barberry is a common ornamental shrub that's invading our forest understories. It's in the early processes of invasion. We really like you to get on top of this now. There's lots of reason to control it. It can dominate these understories, displacing native plants and animals, making it difficult to recreate, and probably most importantly, increases the probability of ticks and potentially Lyme disease being passed on to human and other animal sources. So if you see a population, we encourage that you report that infestation so we can prevent that further spread and help document where it's spreading to. Lots of ways to do this. We recommend using the Great Lakes Early Detection Network app, or if you want to report it on a website, you can do it through the EdMaps website, or just contact a local expert and let them know where you found that infestation so they can report it for you. There are a wealth of resources on how to manage these populations. So if you see these new infestations, we highly recommend that you manage them to prevent impact. University of Wisconsin Extension has developed a fact sheet that highlights the effectiveness of a wide range of these control strategies, and we recommend you search this out on the internet for more information. Good luck in identifying Japanese barberry. And we hope to hear of new reports if you see them. Thanks, and have a great day.